I'm going to talk about some work that was commissioned 3 years ago by Oxford City Council to look at Oxford's food system and to look at the environmental impact of it, but also to look at the natural resource dependencies of it, and also to look at well, what's the most effective what potentially could be the most effective courses of action. I'm going to speak a little bit about that for 3 or 4 minutes, and then Julian's going to talk about what's happened since then. So the food printing Oxford, and I've got a copy of the report here, so it's a real thing, look. The food printing Oxford report and piece of work, it came out of a wider programme of work that I was involved with called How to Feed a City. And the reason I mention that is because before we were commissioned to do Food Printing Oxford, we were interested in the city as a scale at which one might look at food system action. And I think that's for two reasons why we felt it was a compelling scale. The first of those is simply about scale. It's about the fact that very often when one talks about sustainable food system solutions, a good challenge to that is, well, does it really work at scale? Could it actually feed a city? And of course, we all know, you know, the old stuff about it's since 2008, more than half of the people in the world live in cities. So that really is an important challenge. Do our solutions measure up to that scale? So we wanted to get a scaling measure of that. The second reason I think that a city is a compelling scale to look at is because it's an identifiable place. And this is about food culture, I think. I mean, there are lots of reasons why we have a dysfunctional food system in many respects, lots of reasons why there is dysfunction in the food system. And I think part of it might be the context within which people consume food, which is a food system which isn't located particularly. It's a global system, or a national system. And I think the thing about a city is that it's a place that people identify with being in. And so that was something that we thought made it perhaps a more likely place to predispose a food culture that gels better. If you put together government, put together civil society, put together companies at that sort of scale, it may be close enough together that you might get a food culture that gels. So, but actually that's not what we were doing specifically in Food Printing Oxford. What we were doing there was we were measuring Oxford's food footprint as a means of getting to that food culture ultimately. And that was telling us some quite interesting things, like every year there's £80 million. This is a life cycle analysis based study. So we're looking at scope 3 emissions and that sort of stuff. So £80 million worth of oil goes into the food system in Oxford per year. We reported 500 square kilometres of land are required. I think it's more than that. It's half as much again. More greenhouse gases emitted than all the cars, and lots of water. 8 months worth of Thames flow through Oxford worth of water to supply the £500 million worth of food that is consumed in Oxford per year. I think what's interesting about mapping those scales is one, well, actually, it's multi-metrics. And at the time, people were very much looking at greenhouse gases. Second, it's quite eye-catching, and that's quite interesting for getting people to engage. It's that scale thing again. If you're going to come up with a solution, those are the sorts of scales of impacts or dependencies that you need to look at. And then the last thing I'd say is that we frame this not just as environmental impacts, but we frame them as dependencies, as these are the natural resources you require. This is the cost of the oil, because I think that's really relevant to business, and that's really important in terms of motivations to act. So we kind of also looked at, well, what's the most effective courses of action? What are the kind of things you could do? And we came up with this food print calculator and constructed it at great cost to long evenings, which looked used LCA data to look at various different input variables and outputs in order to be able to model what could create scenarios, basically, but also to provide a scenario for others to create their own create a resource for others to create their own scenarios. The kind of things that come out aren't surprising, because it's the same data that other people use in that diet and waste are really, really kind of critical, and level of meat consumption. I think what was interesting and useful about it is that it enabled people to come up with their own solutions, but then to measure whether they really worked. And I think that's important because different people in different parts of the supply chain have got the different abilities to influence different elements of what's going on. Naturally, if you're a farmer, you can influence how you farm.
Can you just talk us through that a bit?
Yeah, I can, absolutely. We did this with a consultancy called Best Foot Forward in Oxford 3 years ago, and basically it's this is a web-based platform, and behind it is a set of algorithms essentially, which are based on published data, and so what we did was where you can input various variables that have an influence basically, so. You could shuffle around the balance of diet by shuffling around how much of very different food groups went in. We put in, you can tick an organic box for each of those food groups, food production, where it comes from, cooking, waste, and where packaging goes. So those we put those variables in, and essentially what they do is they mash it together and come up with these different food footprints for land, energy, water, and greenhouse gases.
That's what you've got on the bottom there.
Exactly that, yeah. Yeah. The thing is, you can come up with great solutions, and we could say, well, you know, you could reduce, you could have a really healthy diet, which, well, you put in Live Well Plate, and you can have a healthy diet that reduces emissions. There are lots of good ways of reducing emissions, but a lot of those are kind of predicated on this notion that they're perfect world solutions. They're predicated on a notion that people are all going to resolve to be good, and so a large part of what we've done subsequently, and we were doing as part of that research, was to look at, well, we need things to make a difference, but we also need people to want to do it or to be motivated to do it. And when I say people, I mean government or business or civil society. And that motivation is, that resonance with people is really important. And I think there's untapped potential there in terms of enlightened self-interest reasons why people might want to do that. But I think to go beyond enlightened self-interest, we also need to look at collective interests, enlightened collective interests. And I think that comes back to the notion of being able to put together different sorts of actors in the system, the citizenry, businesses, government. And we kind of feel that city is quite a good level to do that, because people can imagine it as a place where they actually live. And if their food system's rigged around that, then it might gel. So we came up with some recommendations, which is where Julian comes in.
So I'm going to go through a little bit more of the nuts and bolts as a case study of what Oxford's been doing since this report was published, which was in late 2013. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was published, yeah.
So about a year ago. So as a precursor to that, I think one of the most interesting things for me about this whole thing is that the response hasn't particularly been led by municipal authorities, it hasn't been led by local government. It's really been a civil society, cross-sectoral effort, and local government has been a really important part of that and has been a facilitating agent within it, but it's really much wider than that. And one of the reasons for that, as was alluded to earlier, is budgetary. There really isn't much scope for doing additional work, adding on new responsibilities at this point. The other is that there's no obvious home for food policy in local government. It's very hard to know where a food policy might sit, whether it's, in this case, potentially linked to the sustainability functions of local government, but also health, culture, etc., as we're talking about. The other thing I want to mention is that a large part of our response through Good Food Oxford, which is the new sustainable food network that was set up following the food printing report, is also linked in with a national set of actors, and particularly the Sustainable Food Cities Network, which was launched shortly before we started doing this. So that I think I should just run down. I don't know if any of the organisers are here, but I'll mention briefly what it is. It's a coalition of soil associations, Food Matters, and Sustain, who've come together and said, well, cities are really powerful actors, as we know. Can we do something very conscious to try and promote food policy happening at that level? And as part of that network, Oxford is able to tap into their support and their frameworks for making action. It's quite a light touch approach. but are based around three ideas, three P's, they call them. So first P, partnership, forming a cross-sectoral partnership within a city. Second P, policy, influencing policy. Third P, plan, action plan, AP, to get together with that network that you formed and think through where are the best places to take action, how should we be doing things. So briefly, how we went about it in Oxford, we convened a group, so we held an open meeting. And I think just to point out, the convening partners are potentially important in how these policies or how these processes happen in cities. And we were, our process was convened originally by Low Carbon Oxford, which is a local authority links body, a group of network of businesses, of larger businesses within the city, and Cultivate Oxford, which is a consumer-facing local food co-op with a big bank of consumers within the city. So two quite different organisations being able to tap into quite different networks, bringing together a yet wider pool of people to take this project forward, and endorsed by the City Council. So some important players there from the beginning, and the Food Cities Network. Second thing we did in this process, try to write down a little bit what the principles of sustainable food are at a city level. And this really mirrors a lot of the discussion this morning around at national level of trying to come up with a series of easy to remember, easy to understand ideas. We came up with 9 points on the Good Food Vision there on the left, and you can access that on the website if you want to see in more detail. And also a series of 5 very easy, very actionable ways in which individuals, as well as organisations within the city, can change behaviours. Next thing, building a network, bringing people together around that document, and the process that we use is to sign up members of the organisation or signatories of the charter, who then are brought within the network by being included in email lists, by being invited to events. We've now got over 100 organisations. You can see it's a real mix. It's from the universities to private businesses to organisations to community groups, local council, etc. But all this kind of leaves the question open as to action. These are necessary but not sufficient steps for really doing anything. So I've described the process by which Oxford is building a network that's capable of taking action. This is the point where we really refer back to the food printing and report, and where this kind of research at city level is really important, because it can point us in the right direction for prioritising how we decide to go about things. And what the food printing report really came out with was, well, diet is a really big factor and food waste is a really big factor for greenhouse gas emissions, but also for those other metrics that Tom was describing. And they link into a lot of the other areas that, as a network, we work in. We're not just focused on those things. We try to take a very holistic vision of food, which is also a very challenging thing to do. So I'll just give you a little sketch of one of the things that we've been doing this year, a collaboration with an organisation called Hubbub, a national organisation. The Oxford Pumpkin Festival, great fun. We put it on for about 10 days at the end of the year, around Halloween. And the idea really was to create a buzz around something that everyone can get involved with, something that everyone identifies with, the Halloween pumpkin carving, to try and reach out to new groups, to break out of the existing network of people within the city who are engaged with this kind of issue. And so this is a chef at our local restaurant making pumpkin ravioli for a dinner. At various events, a huge food waste cooking event in the middle of the city. And these are all really trying to focus into the issue of behaviour change around food waste, but it could equally be focused towards dietary change. And then the other aspect of this, feeding into national media attention and policy, and this is where I really want to bring out that cities are not acting in isolation, they don't sit in a bubble. And there's real great potential for cities to either come together and work together, or here we used the what was going on the ground as a hook for media attention. We've got loads of coverage in national papers and national media, a lot of social media. Then feeds into national policy debates. So really creating a circularity from cities. And imagine if we could get loads of cities doing things on the ground and feeding into to national debates. So I think my favorite one is the Sun, which doesn't mince its words with its headline there. There are some other really good, much better headlines than that. But Eat Your Pumpkin was very clear. that is it. So the point I wanted to leave you with was that the city is more than, for us, really more than an actor, that we're not, when we're talking about city-level action in Oxford, we're not talking about municipal authorities, we're not talking about local government, they're part of that picture. We're really talking about the city as a locus for action. It's somewhere where lots of things can come together and we can start to achieve things. We've talked a lot about multi-sector working. I think also talking about multi-level working around some of these challenges is a really interesting place for us to go. How can cities work with regions, work with national government?